So it's 10 o'clock. I would say we start in time, on time. Warm welcome from my side, Victor Kotler. And
good morning, this is Sylvia Schlatthoff. Hello.
So we have the pleasure to welcome you again on our Ball online session series regarding FortiOS version 6.4, what's new. This is the second of a series of three. So we are really happy to welcome you here in this Ball online session. Looking, of course, forward to meet you again in one of our morning sessions planned in September. But up to now, we are still running this Ball online sessions. As you might know, we have recorded the last one. So everybody missed the last session, is at the end and informed where they can download the video and the presentation from the last time. And again, even this session will be, of course, recorded, and all the presented stuff will hand it out. We send you an email as follow-up at the end of the online session. That you have an idea what's planned, we have again some notes regarding our online session that you are muted during the webinar. But of course, you are warmly welcomed to ask questions and submit them via the Q&A or F&A, Fragen und Antworten, if you have a German version. And of course, you can always let us know via chat if somebody is not as good looking as you expect. But in the past sessions, we shouldn't have had any problems technically. But you are really invited to ask questions, which we try to answer during our online session. And of course, at the end, as you will see in our agenda, we will have then a time slot for you. But that you have an idea who is hosting you today, it's always a pleasure to have Sylvia at my side, who will do the really hard stuff of deep dive. Sylvia Schlapphoff, she's head of engineering. She's leading the support team as well as our authorized training center. And Sylvia, it's really a pleasure to have you again for this session.
Thanks, Victor. Thanks for your welcome. And also, I'm pretty happy to have you on my side because you are the expert for all the difficult license stuff and all the other things I do not know. Because I think the technical part with Fortinet is the more easier one, and the licensing and all the other product stuff is much more complex. So great that you are here. Thanks.
Thank you, Sylvia. But let's ask then the audience what is, from their point of view, the easier part, the licensing or the technical stuff. I'm quite confident it is both not so challenging. We make easy life easy for you, hopefully. No. But that you have an idea, the agenda, again, we are in the middle of the intro, but we will just switch over in no time to some sales update points I have prepared for today. And shortly after that, Sylvia will again start with some slides. But as we know her, the main focus will be in a live demo, and I'm really keen to see what she will explain regarding FortiOS 6.4 and some cool features which are provided. And at the end, as usual, of course, you can still put some questions. We try to answer everything we are not aware and we have to check out. We will, of course, send you as well as a follow-up by email later on. All right, so then I would say, let's start with some information. You might have noticed that we have already a new price list change since beginning of this month. So this week, we have just had the mid Q2 price list updates, which are already feed in to our shop and so on. And there have been also some newsletter we have sent out to our German colleagues, and it should be also going out, or it's even went out to you in a French version as well, where we have a lot of quite interesting stuff summarized in a zip format for you as a newsletter. As a reminder, the last time we have had deep dived into the FortiOS 6.4 new services. This is a little reference. What services are new regarding to the 360 service bundle? especially mentioning the Esteban Orchestrator, which will be presented by Silvia today, which is very cool. Unfortunately, IPEN service, we are still not able to show you something because we are again waiting for the release of 6.4.1. More information from Silvia, as well IoT services, quite an interesting stuff. And of course, security rating enhancement, which I personally think is really something we will have a look on that today, is really a very important feature to get some deep, let's say, analysis from Fortinet presented regarding your configuration and conformity. All right, but if you're looking for more details, I invite you to maybe check out our presentation from our Bologna session number one, and as well, maybe the video we have then linked in the email. What is new? I already indicated in the last session that Fortinet has planned, and now it's really there to bring out an entry-level 40 Wi-Fi series, and we are now really happy that we can tell you that the 40 Wi-Fi 40F, the new desktop model with 802.11 AC Wave 2 is released now. It's available. We can offer them. There should be a stock also in Taiwan. The cool stuff is it's a 40F, as we know, a very powerful entry-level machine, a SOC4 based, but it has an extra Wi-Fi single radio, which can be used as a 3x3 multi-user MIMO. And you see the maximum Wi-Fi speeds are quite impressive for an entry-level box. But you have to be just aware, you can choose either the 5 gig or the 2.4 gig radio band, not both because it's a single radio, but you can choose. And it's a quite pretty nice antenna gain as well. An important note, if you have international projects, we always ask you to specify the location of the Wi-Fi product in advance, because as soon we have to order them, we need then to tell Fortinet the correct country code. So everything is correct regarding the regulation domain and so on. You see the pricing, 40F as a hardware only without services starts at 570 Swiss francs. And the Wi-Fi version is a little bit more expensive, but if you look at the Delta, it's not the full price of an access point. It's quite a reasonable uplift for an access point inside. And of course, if you say, I would like to have some more redundancy, there is even now the 3G, 4G version with and without Wi-Fi inside. And you see also the price, the 1099 or 1219 are pretty nice prices for an entry-level box if you have a remote access requirement, a home office, small office. So this is really a cool box to have. They're really a solution. As soon you need a little bit more horsepower, we still recommend the run rate 40 gate, 40 Wi-Fi, 60/61F series. As you might have noticed, the 40F has no 41, so there's no version with a local storage. So if you need local storage, either for having a longer term recording of your log files or for WAN optimization, you have to go for the 61F series. And here again, you see it's quite impressive numbers. Last time we had a little fault in the numbers. The next generation firewall throughput is not 10 gig, but 1 gig, which is even still an impressive number for an entry-level box. But of course, the entire box has 10 1 gig interfaces, and in a pure layer 3, layer 4 firewalling, it has the capability to forward 10 gigs out of the box in line speed with a very little latency. So it's pretty impressive what Fortinet has done with this so-called system on a chip fourth generation. And again, the same radio specifications for the Wi-Fi version, and the price is pretty impressive. Also a nice start by 800 Swiss francs and 1030 for the Wi-Fi version. Sorry, for the 61 with the local storage, and below you see the Wi-Fi version with 920 and 1173. What is maybe to mention is in the upper right corner, you see the 500 tokens which are supported, either mobile or hardware tokens. So also pretty impressive number for having two-factor authentication realized with this box. More regarding Zero Trust will be presented next ball online session with Markus Muth. We have planned in 3 weeks or 2.5. So stay tuned. We will have then also some out you regarding this nice features. And also worth to mention is the pretty high number of access point and switches, which are really higher numbers than you have had before with the 60E, or even depending on the firmware version, Fortinet has adjusted some numbers slightly, that we have now really impressive 64 access points, which can be managed by the FortiGate 60 series and 16 switches. Just to remember, 64 is if it's in the so-called remote mode, not the normal mode, and you have the no CAPVAP, but then everything local bridged. And there's a cool tech blog article on our website where it's explained how to configure this stuff if you need really the maximum number of access points. If you say, okay, entry-level is nice, but I would like to have the real stuff, of course, Fortinet has there a very cool solution. We already teased last time. It is now out officially, the 4200F series. Next Gen Firewall, really a beast. If you look on the numbers, it is really a compact three-unit high, really an hyperscale firewall, which provides hardware-accelerated VXLAN and DDoS support, which is really, really outstanding regarding the single-stream performance. And this is thanks to the new NP7 network processors, which are built in, not just one, but four of them. And in combination with the CP9, we have here really, really impressive numbers. Just regarding to the interfaces, I mean, we have 8 times 100 gig QSFP28 interfaces, can be used as 40 gig as well. We have 18 interfaces, 25 gig SFP28. And of course, you can use them as 10 gig SFP plus and so on. And if you look on these specifications in the table regarding or the compared to the industry average, it is between 5 to 15 times faster related to boxes in the same price spec. So it's really, really impressive. And the pricing is now also official, again, as hardware only. In Swiss francs, it's around 190,000 Swiss francs for the normal version without SSD, local storage, and the local storage version is slightly more expensive, as you can read in the upper right corner. Yeah, so I would say stay tuned. Fortinet has really now an portfolio where you can, from the entry level up to the high end, really provide solutions to a very attractive price performance ratio. So this firewall is for ultra fast firewalling, really suitable. Of course, if you have internal segmentation where you have high bandwidth, you would like to address, it's there. And of course, if you have remote access solution where you have a lot of connections you have to serve, it's also suitable for that. All right. What I would like to give you also some insights, beside of hardware, of course, Fortinet is always developing his or their subscription and SaaS licensing solutions. And you have there some points we just highlight. These are term-based licenses where you still can have for 1, 3, or 5 year validity an offering. The break-even point, if you look on a FortiGate VM V version versus the subscription VMS version, is as soon you have more than 3 years of the same, let's say, solution, the normal version is a little bit cheaper. The flexibility, of course, of a FortiGate VM subscription version is there that you can always upgrade, which is not the case if you have a perpetual license. upgrades are possible via call term at any time, not just in the size, but also in, of course, in the services if you have some changes in requirement. Just keep in mind, it's even with subscription SaaS services necessary that you extend licenses, of course, before the end of their term, so that the operation is working fluently. I have just as an example here the FortiGate VM product line, where you see that Fortinet shows up the differences. The main point is that the FortiGate VMS is comparable to the FortiGate VMV series. There are no FileDOM support, but you can, of course, buy, if needed, some additional FileDOMs later on. And, of course, you see the predictable long-term usage is more for the fully blown FortiGate VMs or the FortiGate VMV versions. And if you have short-term use as scope, then the subscription series is a really suitable solution. Of course, for Elastic use, there is still in the cloud marketplace the possibility for going pay as you grow. If you need something where you have really just a short POC or something you would like to make, then this is of course also a possible way to go. As a reference, I have here a little overview to show you what kind of VM versions are supported depending of the products which Fortinet offers as a VM and also which marketplaces are providing this bring your own license, which is the normal case if you have long-term projects, and of course the possibilities of pay as you grow. I don't want to bother you with details, but this is a reference you can later on use if you have then the presentation in front of you. Also, quite cool stuff is that Fortinet provides a bunch of different wide range of SaaS services and subscription licenses. And to highlight concerning SaaS, software as a service, this is a solution where Fortinet hosts the solution and the customer buys then this via subscription. Mainly currently products which are available in this version are FortiWebCloud, FortiCVP, FortiMailCloud and FortiCASPI. But I'm sure that Fortinet is still providing other solutions as well. So subscriptions are mostly suitable for customers where you would like to switch from a CapEx to an OpEx model and want to have more flexibility. So that is the part from my side. And I hope that, if you have any further questions that you post them in the Q&A part. And so I would say I hand over to Silvia.
Thanks, Victor. Thanks a lot. Yes, there seems to be no questions up to now. Maybe you can give us some more information about the newsletter, for the French newsletter.
Yeah, so as we indicated, and you should already be used of that, we are always sending out a newsletter. And this is something always triggered by price updates. So we have all quarter and mid-quarter price list update from Fortinet, which we then summarize. And as I know from Daniele Regazzoni, the newsletter in French will go out today. So of course, no delay. You will have it in a short time.
Perfect timing, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Victor. And thanks a lot to all the participants. I'm pretty happy to have you here and that you will have some time to have a look into the new technical features of 6.4, especially for two topics today. Today we are talking about SD-WAN and the security fabric and a little bit of routing interface stuff. So that is what we are talking about today. But before we are going to start, I do not want to repeat the slides we had in the first session about upgrading to 6.4, but just because I think this is important, a few warnings. If you have joined the first session, you already know this information, but if not, if you're going to update your FortiGate to 6.4, please be aware that there are a lot of changes with the FortiLink configuration, with the VLAN configuration for the switches. There will be a lot of changes. We will talk about this more in detail in the third session of this series. Marcus will explain everything what's happening here. So you should be aware of this one. Furthermore, if you have a 40 link configured on a desktop model, a smaller one, a 60, and this 40 link relies on a hardware switch interface like internal 1, internal 2, please be aware that you are going that you might get into trouble after upgrading. There's a little issue, so hopefully this will be fixed in 6.4.1. Another thing I want to make you aware of, if you're going to upgrade, the FortiGuard communication is changing to Anycast communication. And we already know that there are sometimes some problems, so it's possible, not very often, but it's possible that you have some issues with the FortiGuard communication, so you cannot reach the FortiGuard web filter service and so on. In this case, you have to disable the Anycast communication. Then there's a little small issue with the SSL VPN with macOS Catalina. Yes, macOS Catalina is a little bit tricky, but we already heard that this is not an issue all the time, but sometimes the split tunneling doesn't seem to work. In this case, you will have the SSL VPN with the default tunnel, with the default gateway. So all of the traffic is going into the SSL VPN. Okay. So last but not least, don't forget to upgrade and to back up your configuration before you're going to upgrade. This is not 6.4 specific. This is always our very important point in case you have to downgrade for some reason. But I'm pretty sure you already know this.
Maybe something from my point of view, from sales part and consulting, it's worth to mention that this link aggregation, which is now possible with the desktop models, this is a really, really cool new feature because in the earlier days, as you might remember, it was just supported by the three digits upward 100 XYZ products. So this functionality that we have 40 link LRCP dynamic on a desktop two-digit version is thanks to new hardware and of course the new software. So really cool that Fortinet did that.
Yes, of course. With the 40 link, this is necessary. So we have this feature with the smaller devices as well. Thanks so much for this information. That's really important. Okay. Some more information about some patch releases. You already heard about 6.4.1. We are waiting for this patch release on a daily basis. Every evening I'm looking into the Fortinet support portal to see if it's already released. As far as I know, it's finished, but it's still in the queue and in the quality assurance. So the Fortinet is testing this release, and when they think it's okay, they are going to release it. So 6.4.1, I think it will be released now, maybe today or tomorrow. Typically, it's Friday evening. Just some more information about another patch update, the 6.2.4. This is the 6.2 major release. So normally, I do not want to talk about this one in this session, but I think it's worth talking about this. 6.2.4 seems to have an issue in some cases, especially if you're working with DOS policies that are the denial of service policy or sometimes it's called interface policies, where you can configure the maximum number of sessions on an interface or the maximum number of packets per second. This feature seems to cause a few troubles on the FortiGate when you're running 6.2.4. So what you will see in this case is that after a few hours, the firewall is stopping traffic which is terminated on the firewall directly, which means we are talking about VIPs, virtual IPs, we are talking about VPNs and all this stuff. This session seems to be dropped if you're working with DOS policies. So just be aware of this one. And the thing is that you will only notice it a few hours after you have upgraded, after the box has rebooted. Okay, just to let you know about this one, I think it's important that you know it. And there's another issue, which is not an issue of Fortinet, but you will see this problem if you're working with FortiGates. And you're using the certificate inspection or the deep inspection on SSL traffic with proxy mode. The problem is that there's an old root certificate which has been expired. I think it's called Setico, something like this. And this root certificate is used for some cross-checking of other root certificates, especially root certificates from Komodo or UserTrust. And a lot of web servers are using web server certificates which are signed by Komodo and UserTrust root certificates. So this means that you are going to have problems in viewing those websites. So if you notice, starting with June 1st, because then this mentioned root certificate has been expired, starting with June 1st, it's possible that you do not see, or that you cannot see all of the websites, especially websites which are signed with the Komodo or UserTrust certificate. So, unfortunately, there's not a real solution right now, but a workaround or different workarounds. So, one workaround is to switch to flow inspection mode, not to use proxy-based inspection mode for this traffic. Another workaround would be to allow invalid server certificates, so that you allow, okay, the server certificate is not okay, but I will allow it. It is okay, but because of the expired root certificate, the FortiGate thinks it's not okay. And last but not least, you can make some bypasses for those websites just by not checking the certificate anymore. So this is not a release-specific issue. So you will see this issue with 6.4, with 6.2, and also with 6.0 and before. This is just a certificate problem. Okay, so just to let you know, yes. So now I think we can start with some technical stuff. And before I'm going to start the live demo, I just want to give you a small introduction into a new 6.4 feature of the FortiManager. I know the session is mainly about the FortiGate and FortiOS, but the FortiManager has been updated to 6.4, and there's one big major new feature, and this one is really a cool one, so I just want to take some minutes to introduce this new feature. I'm talking about the SD-WAN Orchestrator. The SD-WAN Orchestrator is a pretty new feature, not only because of the SD-WAN features I'm talking about in a minute, but also the way how this feature is implemented. So this new feature, the SD-WAN Orchestra, is implemented as an extension to the FortiManager, which means it's something like a plugin or an application that can be installed on the FortiManager later on. So on the right side, you will see a screenshot of the FortiManager, and you have a thing which is called management extension. And when you click on the management extension, you will see that there are two features which can be installed as an application or as an extension. The SD-WAN Orchestra is already installed, and the wireless manager, which is grayed out, means it's not installed yet. So this new possibility to install new feature as extension is pretty nice, because I think we will gain a lot of flexibility with this kind of installing new feature. So like a plugin, you can upgrade the plugin alone without upgrading the whole FortiManager. So if there are new patches or new features for the SD-WAN Orchestra, you just have to install or upgrade this extension and not the whole FortiManager operating system. So a lot of flexibility. And also, if you're not needing this new feature, if you do not need this new feature, you do not have to install it at all. And everything keeps the same way it was before. So I think this is a nice way to make use of some big new feature. So what is this SD-WAN Orchestrator? I do not have a live demo here, because I would have to install a lot of FortiGate for this one, but I will show you some screenshots to give you a small introduction. So what we will see here is the dashboard of the SD-WAN Orchestrator. And as you already might think, of course, we are talking about a central configuration of the SD-WAN feature.
And not only for the SD-WAN, for the internet connection, but also for the VPN configuration. We can configure the VPN between all our devices automatically with the SD-WAN orchestrator. Okay, and that's the whole idea, not only to have a central configuration of VPN and SD-WAN, but also having a central monitoring and analysis of SD-WAN and the VPNs. Okay, so before I'm going a little bit more into detail, I just have to introduce you some concepts about this SD-WAN orchestrator so that you understand how this one is working. So when we are talking about SD-WAN orchestrator, we are talking about regions. Because maybe if you have a big network with one or more headquarters and a lot of branch offices, you can create different regions. So that means in every region you need at least one FortiGate. So in this example, we have some worldwide regions, a region US and a region Europe and so on. But of course, it can be smaller regions, like having a region North Europe and South Europe, or maybe west part of Switzerland and the east part of Switzerland, or something like this. So it doesn't matter if the regions are big or not. So the point is you need one device, one major device per region. Additionally, you can have more devices. So these are some kind of regional headquarters and some regional branch offices. And in the SD-WAN orchestrator, we are talking about hub and edges. We are not talking about headquarters and branch offices. We are talking about the hub device, which is the headquarter device, and the edge devices, which are the branch office devices. So now the idea is that all the hub devices from the different regions are automatically building up a fully meshed VPN. So there will be a fully meshed VPN between the hub devices, between every region, and the edge devices will connect to the hub devices with a hub and spoke VPN. This VPN will be configured automatically as well. So with this, all the devices are connected in some way. Now, when we talk about hub and spoke, you maybe think about the AD VPN, which is a new feature where the edge devices can dynamically establish a VPN if they want to communicate direct. If you have an hub and spoke, normally the spokes or the edge devices communicate via the hub, but with the AD VPN, we can build up a so-called shortcut, a dynamically established VPN between the edges directly. And this AD VPN functionality will be used with the SD-WAN orchestrator as well. So we set up a hub and spoke within the region, we set up a fully meshed VPN between the regions, and now if two different hubs want to talk together, they can build up a shortcut. So right now, this is working within one region. After the next upgrade, we are able to build up shortcuts between edges, between different regions as well. Okay, so now up to now, I've talked about the VPNs only. The VPNs are the automatically configured VPN is called the overlay in the SD-WAN orchestrator. So we are talking about an overlay and underlay. The underlay is is built up by the ISP connections from the devices itself. This is the underlay. And the overlay is the VPN, some kind of a company network which lays on the underlay network, on the ISP networks. Okay, so these are some concepts we are using with the SD-WAN orchestrator. Yes. And based on this, we can have a look into the configuration. So here we are in the configuration of the devices. And you will see in this example that we have two different regions, the Europe and the US. Each region has one hub and two different edge devices. And what you will see here, let's take the mouse, you will see the status of the different devices, which is green and red. And let me go back one slide. The same thing is here in the dashboard. You will see green devices, which means this is a FortiGate which is working properly. If one FortiGate is not working properly, you will see it in red. And the VPNs, the connections between the devices are green, which means, okay, the VPNs are up and running. If the VPN has some problem, you will see it in another color like red and yellow. And also the thickness of the connections between the devices will give you information about the throughput on this VPN right now. So you will see with this dashboard already the status of all of your VPNs, your devices, and if there's a lot of traffic or not. So this is what you can configure here with the devices. You will see the status of the devices, which is green, and most of the times the EU hub seems to have a problem. But nevertheless, we will see the profile here and the role. The role is hub or edge, of course. This is important to know which device is a hub device, which one is an edge device, just for the automatic configuration of the VPNs, like a hub and spoke and the fully mesh between the hubs. But the big magic is here within the profiles. Within the profiles, you will have all of the SD-WAN configuration. And we will go into this a little bit more in detail. But before of this, I just want to mention that zero-touch provisioning is also possible with the SD-WAN orchestrator, which means if you have a new FortiGate, it's not installed yet, but you already know the serial number, you can just create this device here in the SD-WAN orchestrator as a new device with the serial number. And next step is that you have to install the FortiGate somewhere, so you have to connect it to the internet, and maybe via the FortiDeploy feature or via the DHCP, you can inform the FortiGate where the FortiManager is located, the IP address of the FortiManager, and then the FortiGate is automatically connecting to the FortiManager and getting the SD-WAN orchestrator configuration.
Maybe a little hint requirement for the FortiDeploy, if you would like to use this cool feature, this has to be announced to Fortinet in the process of the purchase order. So if you would like to make a mass deployment worldwide and use the FortiDeploy, so we need that to know in advance. It's a single license we have to buy or sell you. It's not very expensive, but then the entire purchase order will then put into a database, and this can be then referenced for this zero-touch provisioning. So please get in touch with us and ask for this special license before you have already bought, because it has to be mentioned and organized via the purchase order at the moment of the sell process.
Okay, thanks a lot. So good to have you here, all the not technical information from one hand. Okay, so now, as I said, the magic of the SD-WAN configuration happens in this profile. So let's have a look into this profile. So there are different profiles you can pre-configure and which can be attached to the different devices. So let's have a deeper look into the profiles. Here we are seeing the profile with four different topics: general with the name and the type, system. Here you can configure some stuff like DNS servers, NTP server, and so on. But it's getting interesting in the network and in the business part. So within the network, you are going to configure the interfaces of the device. The interfaces, which means which interfaces are used as WAN interfaces, because they are connected to some internet links. This might be ISPs or an MPLS or maybe an LTE connection as well. And it's important to know which kind of WAN type it is, because yes, of course, we are using an LTE connection in a different way than a normal MPLS or ISP connection. Okay, so you are configuring the internet connections here, and you can configure in the part here the LAN interfaces. And here is happening something interesting stuff. So what you can do here, you can already assign an IP address for this LAN interface or this LAN network, or also you can auto-assign IP addresses from an intrapool. So this means you're configuring a global address pool for your internal networks of all of your devices. And then you can auto-assign IP addresses to the different devices. So nevertheless, if you're configuring the IP addresses explicitly or you're auto-assigning them, the firewall or the SD-WAN orchestrator is automatically creating address objects out of it, grouping them together into the regions to make regional address groups, and is distributing those address objects over all devices. So you can use it for the next thing, the business rules, the SD-WAN routing rules. So this is done automatically as well. So you already see it's pretty easy to configure an SD-WAN configuration on a lot of devices with this SD-WAN orchestrator. So let's go ahead to the next one, to the business. Business, it's another way, name for the SD-WAN rules. So here we have the routing rules to tell the SD-WAN orchestra or orchestrator or to tell the FortiGates how to route which traffic. So there are two predefined rules, the yellow ones in the bottom, the built-in intra and the built-in. The built-in is a rule which says, okay, if traffic goes to group all as a destination, and this group all is one of those automatically created address objects from the SD-WAN orchestrator, and it contains all the internal networks. So if there's internal traffic from one LAN of one device to the LAN of another device, then this traffic will send over the overlay, which means it's sent into the VPNs. With a policy low cost, use the VPN with the lowest cost. If you have other traffic, not into the internal network, but into the internet, of course, then the traffic is sent to the underlay network, which means directly through the ISP connections into the internet. And in this case, with the low cost profile, which means using the cheapest internet connection from this device. These are some two predefined rules, but also like in every SD-WAN configuration, you can configure specific rules. So there are two different examples here, like the zip rule, which means if we have internal zip traffic, internal telephony, then use the overlay network, which means the VPN, with a policy high quality. So use the VPN with the highest quality. And for example, if you have Office or Microsoft 365 traffic, in this case, use the underlay network with the highest throughput. So you are configuring those rules once, and with the profiles, those rules can be distributed to all of your devices, which is using this profile. So it's pretty nice to have a central configuration of all these rules, so all devices in your company network are using the same rules, and you only have to configure it once and not several times. Okay. So this is the configuration. Now let's have a very fast look onto the monitoring. So here we already have seen this menu dashboard where we have seen the overview with the whole world and all of the devices. Now I have deep dived into one of those devices, the hub of the region EU. And what we will see here at one glance is that we have a firewall which is in good condition, CPU and memory and so on looks very good in this case. And we also see the some top sources or top applications, so some FortiView information. We will see the throughput and the number of session later in the bottom. Maybe you don't see all of this, but here you will have some information about the usage of this device or of all of the devices through the SD-WAN orchestra. So if you go ahead, if you go to the next link, you will see the ISP connections, the underlay network here, how this one is used or how are the ISP connections used, and you can go further on to the overlay network, which are the VPNs. So here you will see all of the VPNs which are automatically connected on your FortiGates, and it seems that all of them are in a good quality, because the point here is at the good, not very good, but at least good. And you also see all the jitter latency information about the VPNs, which is measured automatically. So at one glance, you see all of your internet and VPN connections, the usage of the SD-WAN. And I think this is Yeah, this is the stuff I wanted to show you for the SD-WAN orchestrator. So what's the idea of it? How is it working? And yeah, hopefully I can give you the impression, at least if you have a big network with a lot of devices, it's very, very easy to configure this centrally with the SD-WAN orchestrator. Okay, so if there are any questions, I'm happy to try to answer them. If not, I am taking the next half of an hour for a small live demo. So let's get back to the 40 gates configured, working with FortiOS 6.4. No questions? Okay. So I'm stopping this presentation. Enough of all of those PowerPoint slides. Let's get some hands-on on a real FortiGate. So we have a 60E here with 6.4 installed. And as promised, today we are talking about the security fabric and the networking part, which means the SD-WAN especially, but some other stuff as well. And yes, I already started with the security fabric. You will see the topology here just for a small introduction, what I have built up. It's just a pretty, pretty small network. I have my central FortiGate, my root FortiGate for the security fabric. This is the one I'm working on right now. I have two internet connections, 1.1.1.2, configured in an SD-WAN. And there's a branch of this FortiGate connected with a VPN, member of my security fabric. I have connected this downstream firewall via the VPN interface. And yeah, so this is the main part of this pretty, pretty easy setup. So as you might see here with the topology in 6.4, there are not big changes. So everything more or less looks the same. The first change in the security fabric is the security rating. So with the security rating, we have a redesign. You will see find a redesign of the security rating menu here. So now we have three different scorecards, the security posture, the fabric coverage, and the optimization. With the security posture, you will see, you will get the checks on all the device settings, like the ports for the administration, like timeouts for the administrator or trusted host. This features are checked here with the security posture. The fabric coverage contains all the license checks, the firmware version, versions checks. I'm sorry for this one. And the optimization, the third one here, for example, you will find checks on unused policies and so on. All of the checks are resulting in a score, in a rating between A and F. And you will see by default here with my configuration, I'm not so good. There are some good checks with an A, but also there's one, two, three very bad checks with an F. So I should fix this. So how to fix this? Expand one of the scorecards. And here you will see a little bit more details. So you will see again the rating. You will see the historical line of the security rating. Oh, yesterday something has changed. That seems to be good. So I should continue to make some adjustment so I have correct checks with the security rating. So what are you seeing here now? So you will see some more details about the different checks. And you will get some information. With this, by default, you're seeing the Fortinet security best practices and the information about it. But if you are using PCI, you can switch to the PCI checks as well. So here you will find the different PCI checks with the information about the different PCI checks. Okay, so it belongs to you. If you want to work with the best practices for Fortinet or the PCI. If you're going to check all those security ratings and you want to fix it, here a lot that have failed. So where should I start? And what you can do now is you can add the severity column. So before you didn't have the severity column, now you have one. And here you will have some information. Okay, maybe we should start with the high severity issues. And later on, we can go to the medium issues if they have failed as well. And as you already know, you have those easy easy apply fixes. So let's say here, backup configuration before applying, blah, blah. We have some, the problem here is that we do not have enabled the logging on our firewall policy, which should be enabled. So what we can do, we can just click on apply and then it will be applied automatically. So I do not have to do the configuration automatically by myself, but I can configure them automatically. So and with this, when I run a new security rating check, I will see I would see that my rating is getting better and better. So it's just a little redesign on the security rating, nothing more what we will find with 6.4. Okay, so that's the information on the security rating. Now, let's go to my favorite change, the automation stitches. I think the automation stitches are really a great tool and nobody is using it. So if I have a look on some different customer FortiGates for support, I never see some automation stitches, but they are so good. You can get a lot of automation just by a small configuration here. So what did Fortinet do? With the new installation with 6.4, you are getting some default automation stitches. So just to mention this, you are not getting them if you are upgrading an existing FortiGate from 6.2 to 6.4, but if you are starting a new installation with a factory reset on a 6.4 device, you are getting those pre-configured automation stitches. And what are they doing? Let's have an example. Let's have this one, HA failover, so high availability failover. What you are seeing here is that this is an automation stitch which is triggered by an HA failover. So if a cluster is failing over from one device to the other, then the action is send an email to the administrator, of course. Or let's have another example, easy as well. If the firewall is rebooting, send an email before. Of course, now you might say, okay, this is just the alert email feature we have before. And of course, you are correct. But with the automation stitches, you are much more flexible. So let's create a new one. So we can write an email, not only if a reboot is happening or HA failover is happening, but if anything is happening. So let's have a look in this FortiOS event log. So you can say, okay, if the admin login is failing, I want to start an email. Or if something else is happening, every event log entry from the system event log can be used to create an email or to do something else. It's not only the email, it's something else. If a device is shut down, of course, I will be informed about this one. So you are much more flexible in comparison with the alert emails we knew from the previous versions. So you can create your own trigger, like an event login, like a schedule every 12 hours. You want to start a specific CLI script, for example, and so on and so on. So you already had those features before. So what is new with 6.4? With 6.4, new is the Slack notification. I'm not sure if you are using Slack. It's more popular in the US, not in Europe. But hopefully, maybe we will see some Microsoft Teams notification in one of the further releases. This one is new. And what's also new is the incoming webhook, which means the webhooks you already know. We already knew the webhooks because of the action. So, which says, okay, if there's a reboot, you can start a webhook, which means you're doing a URL call to another device just to inform this device. So, and now it's the other way around. So now another device, a third-party device from our network, can inform the firewall with a webhook so that the firewall is doing something specific. So this is pretty nice. So let's say you have an internal security device which is detecting a client which is behaving very, very bad. So now this device can inform the FortiGate with a webhook, hey, this IP address is behaving very bad, please ban it. So stop him from using the internet, or put him into a quarantine so that he's not able to connect to other devices in his layer 2 network and so on. So now we really have an automation between two different security devices, an internal security device and the FortiGate, and they are communicating together, and the firewall can do some stuff regarding the notifications via the webhook. So let's make an example. I have already pre-configured some examples to give you information how this is working. So here we have this example with a banning IP and a quarantine client. So two different banning mechanisms. Before I'm going to show this, just want to show you, I want to prove that right now there's nothing in the quarantine. No results, it's empty, huh? Okay. So what we are going to do now, let's have a look at those automation stitches. Yes, like this one, ban IP, the name of this automation stitch. If I have configured this automation stitch with the name ban IP, which means the URL call, the webhook is called with the IP address of the FortiGate, and then it's an API call, because of course this webhook is nothing else than an API call. And the API call belongs to the name of this automation stitch. To make it a little bit more easier, here you have a sample curl request which can trigger this automation stitch. So what you need for this is just an API admin key, because we are using the API of the firewall. And for authorization, we need an API key for this. Just to show you this one. The API admin can be configured with the normal administrators. You can create a new one, an API admin. I just go to one which is going a little bit faster. I've already configured one. And instead of a password, you will have an API key. Just to show you this one, you can regenerate this one, and then you will see this API key, and this is some kind of password you're using to be allowed to be authorized to use this API and to start to trigger this webhook. Okay, you can copy this one, and this API key needs to be inserted into the webhook call, into this one. Oops, this was another one, sorry, I didn't copy it. And then it will be inserted into this curl request. So I can use this curl request, but to be honest, I'm a little bit lazy. So I'm using another tool where I can save all those requests. I'm using Insomnia. It's a free tool you can use to create such calls. And I have this call for ban IP, which means I'm calling exactly this webhook request with the name ban IP. And then I can configure the API key. This is the bearer for authorization of the administrator. And here I'm using some parameters, and that's the trick. With those parameters, I can give the FortiGate some IP addresses to ban, or maybe some MAC addresses to ban. Okay, let's try this one, right? So I'm going to send a webhook to the FortiGate with the MAC address 1111. Okay, here I have the result. It's success. That's perfect. Just for testing, I'm using another test, another webhook, the ban IP. I send it. Result is success as well. Okay, so and now those webhooks have triggered the FortiGate. And to prove this one, let's go back to our dashboard, to the quarantine, and you see now we have two different entries in the quarantine, and that are exactly the one I have triggered with the automation stitches. So of course the idea is not to trigger those stitches automatically, but to let another security device from your internal network to trigger the FortiGate if something is happening automatically. And I think this is great to get some interaction between different security devices within your network. And it's pretty easy. You do not have to code a lot of stuff. You just have to copy or create those webhooks. And that's all. Okay, so that are the news about the automation stitches. Let's go back. One last thing here for the security fabrics are the connectors. So we have a little redesign here as well. We are differentiating between the fabric connectors, the Fortinet connectors, and the external connectors. With the external connectors, you already know them. Nothing has changed. Only one small thing, the Nuage and the Cisco ACI connectors, you can configure more than one with 6.4. Before you are limited to just one connector for Nuage and one for ACI. Now you can configure several of them. But the big changes is happening here with the fabric connectors. So if you want to create a security fabric, you have the settings here, but now they are missing because the security fabric will be configured with this icon here. So you can double click on this one. And here you will see the security fabric settings. So you can enable or disable them, can define the fabric role of this device. I'm on the root device. And there's another device in my fabric, which is the downstream device, the FortiGate, which is connected with the VPN. And you will see it here. And here you will already see a next new feature, which is the synchronization wizard. With the 6.4, we are able to synchronize address objects, schedules, and service objects to all of the devices within our security fabric, which means that you do not have to configure or copy them from one device to the other device or configure them separately. You can configure the address objects once on the root device, and then they are going to be synchronized to all of the other devices. So they are not synchronized yet. I just wanted to show this one to you. So let's start the synchronization wizard. So I have only one additional device in my security fabric. So this one is out of sync. So I'm marking it and then I can go to next. Okay. So now I can synchronize it. I just have to wait for a few seconds. Okay. And now I see the synchronization process. So you already see with the address, there seems to be some conflicts. So which means there already seems to be objects with the same name. So what to do with them? So we can go to resolve the conflicts. So now it's up to me if I want to override the devices or if I want to create a different name on the address object on the downstream device. So I can say, okay, rename all of them, and now the conflict is resolved. So you will see it's the same object, but with different names on the different devices. Okay, error occurred to rename. I'm sorry. It should have worked. Okay, because it says it's resolved. Okay. So let's have a look. So I'm going to log into the downstream device. Yes, okay. Now let's have a look at the address objects, for example. So yes, here's the conflict one, and this has been renamed. This looks good. So the funny thing is now if you go into an object, you see that you cannot change it anymore because you are on the downstream device. This is a device synchronized by the master, by the root device. So you're not able to change them. Only the root device, the FortiGate on the root device is able to change them. And if the firewall is going, the root device is going to change an address object, it's synchronized automatically. So only one point to configure all of your address objects, services and schedules. Okay, so that are the changes for the security fabric in 6.4. Now, time is running. Let's go ahead to the network. Here we have some small changes. I just want to introduce them very fast. For example, let's go to 1.2. We have a speed test. So to be honest, we had the speed test before, but only in the CLI. Now we can run it through the web UI, which means the FortiGate is doing a speed test with some AVS and Google servers automatically and give you the results. So you will see the bandwidth of your internet connection here. So this takes some time. In the meantime, we can go to the CLI. Let's go to the CLI. Config system interface, edit 1.2. There's another new feature with 6.4, which is very important if we think about DHCP internet connections. So we are able to configure a DHCP internet connection, like a connection to Swisscom or Cablecom, but now we are able to configure some client options, which are added to the DHCP request. And these client options are very, very important. For example, in Switzerland, for Swisscom, if you're using the All-IP feature, you need a vendor information there. So this would be code 60. But you can use every other codes, DHCP codes as well now, with the DHCP request of the client. You can configure them only in the CLI, but at least we can configure them right now. Okay, so let's go back. Here we'll see our speed test with the upstream and downstream information, okay? And now they are automatically configured for the estimated bandwidth. If I press okay, I have configured those bandwidths for my WAN interface, which is going to be used for the SD-WAN information. So with this information, I know how much my interface is used, how many persons. Okay, so that are the news for the interfaces. Oh, just another one, for the administrative access. So before we knew that we had the CAPVAP and telemetry administrative access, they are combined now with this one, the Security Fabric Connection administrative access. So here you will find the CAPVAP and telemetry you knew from earlier versions. Okay, this is a change as well. Okay, so now let's make a switch to the SD-WAN. Here you will see a lot of changes in the web UI, in the redesign and so on, like the SD-WAN interfaces. Here you will see, you will have a better view on your interfaces. I have WAN 1 and WAN 2. You will see some specific bandwidth information, but also you will see it here with the graphics, the volume, the number of session. It's much easier to see how the different internet connections are used with the internet connection. If you create a new interface, it's pretty easy here. You just have to choose one, like the DMZ. You can configure the gateway. If the DMZ is a dynamic interface, which means it's connecting with PPPoE or DHCP like the WAN 2, then it's automatically, you can configure the gateway dynamic, and then the gateway we learn from the DHCP or PPPoE is used automatically. So this makes life a little bit easier for configuring the SD-WAN members, especially the dynamic ones. Okay. So that are the news for the interfaces. Let's have a look into the rules. Here you will have some graphic optimizations as well. So let's have a look here. So the first one, the most important, I think, is the check mark on the member. With this check mark, you automatically learn which interface is used right at this moment. So for this rule, we are using WAN 2 because it has the best measured performance, because my criteria is based on the bandwidth. And this one meets the SLA, WAN 1. This is the reason why this one is used for this rule. And here I have a manual mode method. And now it's WAN 2. It's the first one which is working. So this is very great information that you know which one is used for which rules. So this is a tooltip just with a mouse over event. If you have a mouse over event on the interfaces, you're getting more information. You're getting the information about the performance SLRs. So here I will see the latency information for the different SLRs. And if I have some specific SLR targets, which means I need to have 1 millisecond latency on a specific target, you will see it in red or green if this target is met or not. So just with a mouse over event, a lot of information about your interfaces. Okay, so if you look into a rule like this one, you will see some more information here on the right side. You will get information about the SLRs, which is used for this rules. You will see the hit count, and you will see more information about the methods you can choose for the rules. So a lot more information you will see on the first glance. Okay. The hit count, And the last used information, this is very helpful as well. So you can see if the rules are used or not, because it's very important with those rules. The order of the rules is important, you know. And if you have a wrong order, maybe the rule, a specific rule, is not used. And you can check it pretty easy with the hit count and the last used. Okay. Yes, that are the information about the SD-WAN rules, what has changed here. And last but not least, I want to have a look into the performance SLRs. Here, with the, again, with the new factory device using 6.4, you will get some default, some pre-configured performance SLRs. If you are upgrading your firewall, you do not get those pre-configured SLRs, pre-configured performance SLRs. Yeah, with the SLRs, you have a new web UI as well. You will see all the information about packet loss, latency, and jitter. Okay. Here I'm not getting information because no interfaces are attached to this SLR. If I'm using this one, I'm getting the information about jitter, latency, and packet loss. Here as well, if I'm matching the targets or if I'm not matching the targets. What is new? You can see it already with this pre-configured one here. We have a new protocol for testing the internet connections, which is DNS. You can just use the DNS request to measure the internet connection and the jitter and the latency and so on. This one might be very helpful. You can use the system DNS from the firewall, or you can configure your own DNS. You can specify your own DNS here. Okay. By default, if you're creating a new SLR, you will see that automatically all SD-WAN members, all SD-WAN interfaces are member of this SLR. So you do not have to add them manually like before. Okay. Yes, and the other thing which has changed is the number of the SLR targets. Maybe if you are using this feature, you notice that you can have more than one SLR target. And now in the web UI, it looks like you only can have one target and not more. Of course, you can have more, but nobody is using this one. So the Fortinet has disabled this add more targets in the web UI. But you can configure more targets in the CLI. And if you do so, like in this example, you will getting the information about the multiple targets here in the web UI as well. Okay, so nothing has changed. It just looks a little bit different than before. Okay, so a lot of new good improvements on the SD-WAN in configuring this. And last but not least, the biggest improvement on SD-WAN is the logging. As you know, we already had the specific SD-WAN logging here. So if I go to the events, system event logs, I will have the subtype SD-WANs between others. And here I will have all of the different logs for my SD-WAN configuration and monitoring. So what has changed here? So you are getting more specific information in those SD-WAN logs. Before, all of the information are mentioned in the message. So in the message, you had a lot of information about the interfaces, about SLAs, and so on. And you always had to search in the message. Now in the message, you just have a short message, and you have much more information in specific columns of this table. So you have, for this example, you have an old value, new value, which is the interface which is used. Or maybe, let's have another one. Here you have an information about the SLR target ID and the members. So now you're having more columns, specific columns, where you can search for specific situations situations. So this is a big improvement, which is, I think, pretty helpful if you're using SD-WAN. I think you will see it if you're using it. Hopefully not yet. Maybe we are waiting a little bit for upgrading to 6.4, but I think there are some great features which are worth for using it. Okay, so time is running out. That's why I'm coming to the end of my live demonstration for the Security Fabric and the SD-WAN. So I just want to give us some more time for some questions. So if you have any questions, just ask them in our questions Q&A tool. So right now there seems to be no questions. We are going to wait for some minutes. So in the meantime, I hope you enjoyed some new feature. I hope some of them are helpful for you. So I'm going to end my live demonstration and going back to the presentation, because we have some more information about some upcoming events. So in the meantime, when you can write some more questions, I will hand over to Victor, because there are some news for some events.
Thank you, Silvia. So it was, as usual, quite a lot of information, and I hope you enjoyed it as well, all these details. What is quite cool, if you are looking for a deep dive technically, we all know that Fortinet was giving year by year this expert summit, experts academy, which was a very cool happening in France, where you could meet, of course, not just your colleagues from Switzerland, from Fortinet and the distribution and other partners, but the cool thing was, of course, get in touch with some very clever guys from Fortinet. Unfortunately, still this current healthy situation doesn't allow these gatherings in real life. But Fortinet has just announced a few moments before this save the date, and we are glad to promote this, that you are aware that from the 29th of June up to the 3rd of July, there will be an expert summit, but as a digital edition, and hopefully one or the other from you or your technical staff can join this very important platform as well. Yeah, and as we mentioned, we will send you all this information by email as a follow-up, and we have also linked the first Ball Online session, What's New Part 1, where you will find the presentation as well as the link to the video. So this is the English version. Of course, if you're looking for a German version, ask for that. This is, of course, also somewhere around. And I would really recommend, if you find the time in 2.5 weeks on the 24th of June, where we will deep dive in our last of this triple of What's New, the third part related to secure access, zero trust network access, which will be mainly then presented by Markus Mood, which is a really an long-term expert. Some of you know him from support, as well as a teacher in the area of Wi-Fi and switching. And last but not least, of course, heads up for our cool, hopefully then in real life, planned morning session. In this matter related to Fortimail version 6.4, which is out now for a short period of time. Also some information around integration of Office 365. And this is an opposite, let's say, order. So you will be first in Lausanne on the 8th of September, and for the German-speaking part on the 9th of September here in Wettingen. And we are quite confident that up to then, we will be able to make it possible to make it as a morning session in Lausanne or here in Wettingen in this flavor, as you know, in real life. And we are looking forward to meet you there. Yeah, so I would say that there is just my last few words. A big thanks to Silvia for, again, all this preparation and deep dive.
Thanks so much. Thanks to you as well. And especially thanks to all of our guests. It was great that you find some time to join us for this session. Thanks so much. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, and so I would say we keep now the Zoom session open. If you have still some questions, please feel free. We will try to answer them later on and send the Q&A as well then with the presentation and the link to the video, which can be shared internally with your colleagues. Okay, it was great to have you online, and hopefully seeing you in real life also
soon.
Yeah.
So, thanks so much. Have a great day. Enjoy your lunch and, of course, stay safe.
Yeah. Merci beaucoup. Bon appétit. À prochain.
À prochain. Bye-bye.